All right, welcome to our next microcontroller video. We are still working with the PIC10F200, and if you may have wondered why in the world we had it set up with two LEDs and two switches this entire time and haven't used them yet, this tutorial is why we have it set up. So in this tutorial, we are going to learn how to use buttons. We are going to learn exactly how you scan for them. We're going to learn a little about pulling and the debounce delay and how to do that in software. And then we are going to do some fun things. So we're going to basically do two things. We're going to make one of the buttons cause it so when you push it, the light blinks the entire time you're pushing it, and the other one that when you push the button and release, it changes the state. So if it's off, you push the button, it turns on. I just did my hands backwards there, but you know what I mean. You push the button and it changes on to off, off to on, just one time per push. One time per push. There we go. This is going to be a little bit more complicated than the things we've been doing, which makes sense because each one of these tutorials, we should be learning something new and learning something a little bit more complicated. So let's get right into it. One of the first things I want to know as you're looking at the code that Sergey has put together is, if you haven't seen it before, a pipe, basically that vertical line, in this case is treated as an OR. So as you're looking at the initialization for that move literal and on lines 8 and 10, where it has T0CS, pipe, and then one, less and less than, not GPPU. That is just a way of making it so you are toggling both of those bits without having to do much more complicated or just more painful things. So that pipe in that middle, that vertical line, is just an OR, and you'll see that in C, C++, all of the bitwise operations that you see in other programming languages. So I just wanted to point that out. So with that, you look in here and you see the first 11 lines are our typical initialization. We move something to the working register on line 8, and then on line 9, we move what's in the working register into the option register, and then 10, move some new values into the working register, and then line 11, we move that into the TRIS register. So the actual program itself, the entirety of the main program, is literally lines 12 through 15, where you have loop, call, check switch 1, call, check switch 2, and then go to loop, and you're just going through that. And that's literally it. Everything else is being run as a subroutine. So what we're doing here is called polling. Now on a very simple microcontroller like this, you don't have interrupts. You don't have something that as you're going along, something will flag it and say, oh, something happened over here. I need to stop what I'm doing right now, go run a specific subroutine, and then come back. This doesn't do that. So that's just one of the side effects of having such an inexpensive microcontroller. But because we don't have those interrupts to make it so you detect a change on a pin or something like that, we have to pull and actively look, what is the value on that pin right now? And this is an incredibly inefficient way of doing it, but it's also, for something this simple, extremely effective. And there's no reason that we need to worry about, oh man, it just has to check all the time, because what else is it going to be doing? So pulling, if you were building a nice big complicated project, you would not do this because it unnecessarily uses its processing power. But since, again, we don't have anything else going on, it's not a big deal. So lines 13 and 14, all we're doing is polling switch 1, checking, hey, is switch 1, has it changed state? If it hasn't, then it goes to check switch 2. So as we look under check switch 1, the subroutine, you will see the first and the only new command we are going to learn in this particular program, and that is BTFSC, and that is bit test in the file register skip if clear. So what we are doing is we are looking at register GPIO and the bit GP3, and we test it. And what that means is, since it's set up as an input, if the switch has made it a high or low, then it says, oh, it's a high or it's a low. Great. And then it returns that and it says, all right, if it's a 1, if it is set, then skip the next line. So we see that sort of command in assembly a lot. So what it's basically saying is, hey, if bit GP3 in the GPIO register is set, if it's 1, if it's high, then skip the next line. And that next line is that return literal W, where it takes the value from the stack and it puts it back into the program counter to jump you back into the main program. So what that's saying is, if this is high, then that means it's doing what it's supposed to be doing. Because right now, the way we have this set up, if you need to go back and check the diagram again, that's great. But it's set up so it is a pull-up register, so it should be high, except for when we push the button and basically attach that GPIO to ground and pull it low. So this checks and sees, hey, it's high. That means we haven't pushed the button, so I'm not going to skip it. so jump back up into the main loop. However, if you do push the button and it drops low, it'll say, hey, it's low, skip that command, that return literal to W, so I don't go back into the main loop, and then I go to the debounce delay. So one of the interesting things about a debounce is you can do this in hardware or software, but what it's doing is it's making it so that we're making up for the physical imperfections of a button. When you push a button, you'd think it's nice that it's gonna be, if we're going from high to low, it's high and then low. And that would be ideal. However, even the best buttons will go high and then kind of bounce a little bit and then low. And the other way, when you release it, it goes low, bounces a little bit and goes high. And it's that bouncing from high to low that you're trying to get rid of, ergo a debounce. And you can do this in hardware with a capacitor so that when you push it, instead of it bouncing, it just kind of goes like that. And there's pros and cons to doing it in hardware and in software, but the whole point of this debounce delay and this debounce routine is making it so that when you push it, it's not just some stray signal, some change, but you actually pushed it and held it long enough for it to be certain that, yes, this button is being pushed. Now, even though it's called debounce delay, if you go down and you check that lines 42 through 51, you'll notice that's just a typical delay loop. And so literally all it's doing is it's saying, hey, it looks like it's been pushed. Let's wait a little bit of time and check to make sure that it is still pushed. So when you call that debounce delay, you come back in line 21 and you run the exact same thing that you did in line 18. And if it is still low, if it's still pushed, then it skips line 22. We're now at 23, where we're doing the exact opposite command as 18 and 21. Instead of skipping the line when it is clear, you're skipping the line when it is set. And so now what it's basically waiting for is it says, you've definitely pressed it, but I'm not gonna do anything until you've released it. So now we're doing kind of the same thing that we were before, waiting for the release before we toggle the LED. So that go to $-1, as you remember, that dollar sign is the current program counter, the current PC. So every time you hit line 24, it just bumps you back up to 23. And it's waiting until 23 is released. And then if it is, it checks that debounce delay because again, that bounce happens in both directions. And then once everything's good and you've had the debounce delay and you've checked and made sure you've actually released, that's where in 26 and 27, you toggle the GP1 pin, which is basically the LED. So again, as you're going through this, it's checking, have you pushed the button? If so, double check to make sure it's actually been pushed. Once you've double checked and been assured that it has actually been pushed, then you sit and wait for it to be released. As soon as you release it, it makes sure that you actually have released it. And once you have, it does that toggle of the LED and then bumps you back up into the loop of the checking switch one and the checking switch two back into that polling section. So that is it for switch one. And that's a little bit simpler because you're not, that's the one where you push it and it toggles every time. Whereas with switch two, as you push it, it then has to toggle while it's holding. So that's gonna be a little bit more complicated, but still not too bad. So let's jump back into the code with check switch two. And you'll see that this is very, very similar. And the first thing it's doing is when it's polling, it's saying, hey, is GPIO, is it zero? Has switch two been pressed? If not, then jump back out, go back to the polling. If so, call that debounce delay. Now, because this will be toggling the entire time, it calls the debounce delay, and then it goes into this switch to loop. And this loop is where it basically checks, makes sure that it is still pressed. If it's not still pressed, it bumps you out of the subroutine. But if it is still pressed, then it toggles the LED, calls the toggle delay, which is a different length of time than the debounce delay, and then goes back up to the switch to loop. Line 35 checks, is it still pressed? If not, jump out of the subroutine. If it is, 37 and 38, toggle the GPIO, wait, you know, again, about an eighth of a second before jumping up, double checking, making sure it's still pressed, and doing that forever and ever until you release it and then it jumps back up. And so that is really it. And this is something where it is interesting with the PWM, it's a little bit harder conceptually to figure out, but for me, this one is easier to understand, but it's more complicated. There's more moving parts here and more things to go wrong. But if you do all of this, it should work out just fine. And to prove that, let's load this thing up and get it working. Okay, let's see, this thing should be programming. Okay, this is exactly what happened the first time I did it. You notice it's blinking right now, and it's not supposed to be blinking. And that is because of the PICKit 4, and he uses a PICKit 3, and it happened with him. So as far as I can tell, it's the same problem with all of the PICKits. But because our programming lines or actually I'm not 100% sure what lines those are, but because two of the lines from the programmer are connected to our switch pins, you have to pull those pins for it to work properly. So now you see the LED has stopped blinking, and as I push this one, you can see the light. It waits, and I'm pressing, and like I mentioned, it waits until you release, and then it switches, press, waits, releases, and then the other one, as you press it and hold it, it blinks. So I know the green one is a little bit harder to see, so hopefully you can see that. Now also notice that as I'm pressing one, the other one doesn't work, and that's one of the drawbacks of a polling type routine, is that since it's just in that loop, it doesn't care what I'm doing with the other one, and I can do the same thing here. It's whichever one is being pressed first. Now, another challenge here is this is set up fairly well. Let's see if I can do this without causing any problems. But it, I bumped it with my arm. Now it's all confused. So if you just do it too fast, it thinks that it's some sort of bounce. So you do have to do it at least at a semi-reasonable speed. And you have to be really, really fast to not do that. But that's something where you can say, oh, I need to be able to push it super duper fast. So you decrease that debounce delay. And if that's the case, then you're going to be more open to extraneous signals coming in and causing problems. So there's always a trade-off. For me, this is perfect because there's no reason you should be going like that. And it still works most of the time anyway. One of the beautiful things about this setup though in the program is that you can use this module and basically copy and paste this into any of your projects. So don't think that's cheating. Don't think that, oh man, I gotta recreate it from scratch every time. That's ridiculous. Once you create it and you get it working and you get it refined and you make it portable on purpose, use it as much as possible. Why reinvent the wheel? It's just crazy. So that's basically it. That is how you read a button in the PIC10F200 using assembly. As always, if you want to learn more, we highly recommend doing Sergey's recommended homework. Now, in this case, what he's thinking is making it so every time you push the button, you show the number of presses as a binary number here. So basically treat this as the first digit and this as the second digit, and then have that go one, and then turn off two, and then have them both turn on three, and then have them both turn off. The solution that Sergey came up with, actually you learn two new commands, and it's AND WF and RLF. Now he doesn't actually give that to you in the written portion of the tutorial, so that's one of the benefits of watching the video and learning something else, so that's a little bit of a hint. I hope that was interesting. I hope you learned a lot about debounce. I hope you learned a lot about assembly again, as always. And if you like this video, give it a like, subscribe to our channel, and we'll catch you on the next one.